baptism. Something God gave us to unite us in His Holy Spirit, and Satan uses to divide us. I remember when I was a baby.
I got you. Go ahead.
Kind of interesting in this area. There's a raging debate over whether you baptize babies or not. And where I grew up, didn't matter if you went to church or not, you were a bad parent if you didn't have your baby baptized. I was baptized as a baby. Don't remember it, but it happened. And it doesn't matter that I don't remember it, because I wasn't doing anything. God was doing something. And my parents made promises to raise me in a way that would lead me to God, that they would cooperate with God, getting me to the point where I could say yes. Later on in life, I was attending a Lutheran church, and I went to the pastor and I said, I want to get rebaptized. I was baptized as a child, and he looked at me and he says, baptism in our church is something that God does. It's not a human action. It's something God does. And to ask for a rebaptism is to insult God and tell Him that He got it wrong. And we're not going to do that. Now, if you want to reaffirm your baptism, we'll do that. And so I reaffirmed my baptism. I found out, as I went through seminary, that was true of 95% of the Christians in the world, that baptism is God's action. It doesn't matter when you had that baptism, He didn't get it wrong. A man, he was attending Beulah, he was telling me, he was in his late 80s, he was telling me how he accepted Jesus Christ, and he said to the pastor, he says, when God came into my life, and the pastor looked at him, he said, God was there all the time. You're just now seeing Him. God was with you your whole life, not just in that one moment. God was there all along. Why do I believe in baptism? The question isn't water and it's not age, it's God versus man. I believe that baptism is a sacrament of the church, not an ordinance. Now, a sacrament, churches that believe that baptism is a sacrament. I believe that baptism is God's actions. And what we do in our baptism is say, look what God has done in my life, from my birth, what God is doing, and what God will do. And it's all His actions. It's all His promises. And we just, as parents, promise to keep the covenant that God makes with us as an infant. And an ordinance, well, that belief started in the Enlightenment when the individual became all important. And everything was about the individual. And they didn't like God interfering in your life, so they came up with what was called deism, which means basically that God put the world on autopilot and doesn't interfere, except when He comes down and asks you to be saved. And if you say yes, you're saved, and He'll come back to you when you die and finish His work in you. But if you say no, He won't return and ask you again. It's a baptism in that situation. They call it an ordinance because they're simply obeying the order of God to do this. God does nothing in that baptism. It is a human being standing up and saying, look what God did. covenants are promises from God of what He is going to do. And in the baptism covenant, we promise to cooperate with God. But He does the heavy lifting. He does the real work through His Holy Spirit, which is granted to us, and which guides us throughout our lives to the point where we can say yes to Him, and then from that point on, He continues to work in our lives, making us the people that He created us to be. As parents, as adult individuals, and as a congregation, during a baptism, we promise to cooperate with God in fulfilling His covenantal promises in the life, whether of an adult or an infant. God promises to work to lead us to Him from our birth, and I believe that God keeps His promises. Why do I believe in baptism? God is the God of covenant, and God makes promises in those covenants, and God keeps His promises. The Bible is the story of God's covenantal relationship with us. We separate the Bible into the Old and New Testament. Well, Testament means covenant, the Old and the New Covenant. The Old Covenant was a series of covenants that built upon each other, leading to the New Covenant of Jesus Christ. The New built on the Old, and it didn't do away with the Old. It built on it. The Bible is the story of God making covenants, promises, and how He keeps them. People do not make covenants with God. God makes covenants with people. When your airplane is falling out of the sky and you say, God, if you will save me, I'll become a preacher. Well, that doesn't hold God to anything because He didn't make that covenant. You made the covenant. God makes covenants, not people. Anybody took disciple Bible study, that was in there, by the way. God makes covenants, not people. I believe in baptism because baptism is God entering into a covenant with us and making promises to us. We present ourselves or our children for God's work of entering into a personal covenant with Him. I believe that God will keep those covenants and promises with our cooperation, and even despite our lack of cooperation. I mean, it's not like we cooperate with our parents when we're growing up. You know, we're not probably going to cooperate with God either. Paul in 1 Corinthians 12:13, for in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews, Greeks, slaves, or free, and we are all made to drink of one Spirit. Paul is telling us there, this is not a man's action, this is an action of God. We are baptized by one Spirit, not by man's action. In Ephesians 4:4-6, there is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to be, to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. Baptism was created to unite us all in one covenantal body of Christ through the Holy Spirit. It isn't just a man standing up in church and saying, look what God did in my life. In a Methodist church, baptism is about what God has done in our whole life that has led us to this point, and not just one important part of it, what He's doing and what He will do in the future. We don't stay frozen in time. We grow, we change, we work to become, to allow God to make us the people that He created us to be. And instead of uniting people, people have used baptism to divide the body of Christ. People have used baptism as something to divide Christians. We are to be united as one in our baptism, not divided. And baptism is a part of God's covenantal system of restoring relationships, especially with Himself. When I say that I believe in baptism in this corrupt and divided world, I first must explain what I mean by baptism. The Bible is full of covenants going back to Adam and Eve. The covenant that started the covenants through baptism is God's covenant with Abraham in Genesis 17. God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant, you and your offspring after you throughout your generations. This is my covenant. which you shall keep between me and your offspring after you. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskins, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. Throughout your generations, every male among you shall be circumcised when he is 8 days old. Circumcision was a sign that you were in a covenant with God, and it was to be done on the 8th day of an infant male's life. Sorry, maybe you weren't included in the covenant at this time. Baptism allows everyone to be in a covenant with God, not just men. But God said, bring the children into my covenant at 8 days. By God's command, babies were brought into the covenant on the 8th day. By God's command, babies were brought under God's promises. God's promises weren't withheld from babies. During the time of Moses, long after Abraham, the book of Leviticus was written telling the people of Israel how to act and how to worship. And Leviticus chapter 12, verse 3, on the 8th day, the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised. You were brought into God's covenant on the 8th day of your life. And in the New Testament, in our scripture for today, Paul says, and him also you were circumcised with a spiritual circumcision. He's talking about baptism. And it's not God's action. It's a spiritual baptism. By putting off the body of the flesh in the circumcision of Christ, when you were buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through the faith and the power of God who raised him from the dead. He's saying that baptism replaces circumcision as the sign of the covenant with God. He does not drop the requirement for infants to be baptized and brought into the covenant as God commanded. Had a good friend. Actually, his name was Jimi Hendrix, not the famous one. And he was a Baptist minister, and we were arguing about this, and he came up to me the next day after the argument, and he says, you're right, we should be baptizing children. I said, well, which of my arguments did he say? Oh, none of your arguments. He says, I noticed that in the Bible, there is no argument about infant baptism. They argue about everything else that the Jewish people used to do that they dumped. And that means they didn't dump, bringing children into the covenant. There was a man, Polycarp, the last disciple to learn directly from an apostle. The apostle was John. And when he was commanded to turn from Jesus or die, he alluded to his baptism as an infant, and that he will not turn from Christ after all his years of light. If anyone knew what the apostles taught, it was Polycarp, who was the last person to sit at the feet of the apostle and be taught. And he was baptized as an infant, not an adult, probably by the apostle John. A man, Aristides, died in 148 AD. He was actually a non-Christian writing about Christians. And he wrote about Christians baptizing infants and wrote, when a child has been born to one of them, they give thanks to God by baptism. If, moreover, it happened to die in childhood, they give thanks to God the more. As for one who has passed through the world without sins, even non-believers knew that early Christians baptized babies. Jesus is circumcised on the 8th day. Like all Jewish parents, Jesus' parents entered Jesus into a covenant with God the Father. And the promises were to cooperate with God and bring in Jesus to the point where at age 12 or 13, he could take responsibility for his covenant to cooperate with God. Jesus, age 12, goes to the temple for his bar mitzvah and accepted God as his Lord. And the Methodist Church, in 90 to 95% of Christianity, we would say Jesus was confirmed at age 12. Age 12 was considered the age in which you were mature enough to tell good from evil and you became an adult. The vast majority of churches baptize infants, about 95%. The Roman Catholic, Orthodox, Anglican, Episcopal, Presbyterian, ARP, Lutheran, different types of Methodists. Why? It's biblical. Added to the scripture I've read so far, Jesus said, let the babies come to me. In Luke 18, 15 through 17, People were bringing even infants to him that he might touch them, and when the disciples saw it, they sternly ordered them not to do it, but Jesus called for them and said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not stop them, for to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And the first reference to children in that scripture is a Greek word, bret, and it means infants or those not born yet. And the second Greek word is patein, which means little children under the age of 7. In early Christianity, a book was written that almost made it into the Bible. It was called the Didache. And it is also called the Teaching of the 12 Apostles. It was written, depending on who you talk to, between 50 to 70 AD or early 100s. Peter, Paul, and most of the apostles were still alive in the 50s, and they didn't object to it. It was in two parts. The first part talked about their moral life. The second part talked about, well, it gave instructions on how to work and do baptism, to perform communion, to consecrate people for service. It was a how to do the rituals of the church book, and most mainline Christian worship services go back in some form or another to the Didache. Ours is the United Methodist Book of Worship. The second part on how to do rituals of worship starts with how to do a baptism, which is to be confirmed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Not creator, redeemer, sustainer, as they were doing, I think it was in the 90s. Baptism should be done in living water. That's natural flowing water. If it can be had, if not, in cold or even warm water. Most church immersion tanks do not adhere to the higher standard of living water. If the water is insufficient for immersion, it may be poured over the head. Sprinkling or pouring or immersion was determined by how much water was available. You didn't gather by the river if the Roman soldiers were going to kill you in mass for being there. You hid in the catacombs and sprinkled. If you desire to join the church, there's questions I ask, I'd say, how have you been baptized? There's only one baptism. We don't do it multiple times. Ephesians 4, 5, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. If you say, no, I haven't been baptized, I say, you want to be sprinkled, immersed, or poured? I've never had anybody say poured. I am really looking for the day that somebody says pour, where I can take a pitcher of water and pour it over their heads. If any of you haven't been baptized, when I was at Beulah, I did 6 immersions in Lake Murray, which is living water, free-flowing water. See, the real debate is God, is baptism God's actions or human action? The real debate is baptism a sacrament of God's action or an ordinance of human's action? In the writings of Paul, baptism secures purification from sins, the putting off of the sinful body of the flesh, death of sin, renewal of life, regeneration, the power of the Holy Spirit, communion with the life of Christ, incorporation into the spiritual body of Christ, the church. Throughout the New Testament, baptism appears to be represented as a means for obtaining real objective effects, which God has their cause, not just as a symbolic act. In the Bible, baptism is described as a sacrament. God's action. Look what God has done in my life. From birth, what is he doing? And look what he will do. Before I go any further, there's one point I have to make. You don't have to be baptized a Christian, and it doesn't make you one. So why do I believe in baptism? It's a covenant of oneness in the body of Christ. I believe in that oneness of life and will and purpose of God to you. I believe in baptism because it's a covenant and a promise made by God, and I believe God's promise to you. I believe in baptism that we are allowing God to work on us rather than just making an announcement to you. I believe in baptism as God's action, not a human action based best expressed through infants as God commanded. What do you believe? Let's take a moment of silent reflection on the reading of the scripture. Understand that there is nothing spiritual we can do on our own without you. That everything that we do that draws us closer to you, closer to others, first comes to you and your actions, your spirit. Help us to always be aware that it's your spirit that drives us, that guides us, and helps us to grow, to be in your image, to be a part of you.